Alette Petzen.
Thank you.
The lady in red.
Raspberry.
Alexander asked a question earlier on today. How many of you are leaders? Quite a few. And please, especially you leaders, pay attention now, because Alette is going to talk to us about how to lead with happiness. Alette.
Thank you. Also, I have another question. How many in here intend at some point in their career to become a leader? Also a few, so that it's for you too. Or this speak will also be for all you, the employees, that will go home and tell your leader, your immediate manager, happiness at work, we need to do something about it. So leading with happiness is the topic. We all here today know that happy companies are more successful. Companies with happy employees are more productive, happy employees, they are more engaged, more motivated, they are even more resilient. So it's a really good strategic idea to have a happy company. But we also all go to work sometimes and have a bad day, right? But being happy at work is not only about having a lot of happy days, it's about to have less of the bad days at work. And we made a small survey, both inside Denmark and outside Denmark, where we ask people, do you have a bad day at work once a week, several times a week, maybe once a month, or once every 2 months, or once a year maybe? How often do we have a bad day at work? And the results came out like this. We have here both the Danish and the other countries up here. And when you look close into this, you'll see that in Denmark, the almost happiest country in the world, we have about one third that have at least one bad day a week, at least one day that's bad every single week. But outside Denmark, it was actually two thirds. So maybe, just maybe, that's why we are having the happiest workplace in the world. That's in Denmark. I think that could be one of the reasons. So what we need to work on is taking these down, so have less of the bad days. And how do you do that as a leader? Because number one factor that makes us happy or unhappy at work, that's the leadership. A lot of people quit their job because they have a bad relationship to their immediate manager. That's crazy that you don't teach your leaders to be happy at work and to create a happy workplace. Gallup even found out that at least 70% of the variance in the engagement of employees comes directly from the managers. At least 70%. So as a manager, if you want a happy company, if you want a successful company, become a happy company. Create a happy environment with happy employees and you'll have happy customers. Happiness at work is a leader's most important task. It should be your number one task, not looking at the KPIs, budgets, strategic stuff like that. Create a happy company. And how do you do that? I brought a lot of slides with me today, and for those of you who are joining us for the workshops tomorrow, I'll go even deeper into each one of them and a bit more. But just a few quick tips that I'll give you right now. So first of all, how do you create a happy workplace? Start being happy yourself. Ooh. But again, be authentic. And that's actually one of the most important things, is be authentic, but become happy. Create a job for yourself where you can be happy, where you feel that it's meaningful to you, that you can see that you are actually helping your employees to flourish. They want to do a good job. They go to work not to become happy. They go to work to do a great job. When they're happier, they'll do a better job. And it's up to you to help them do a good job and to help them flourish so they can become happy as well. But you have to start with yourself. First of all, find out what's meaningful to you. What's the purpose in your job? And then also communicate meaning and purpose to your employees. And they're all different. They're all different. For some of your one of your employees, it's something specific that's meaningful to her. And for another one, it's something else. So you need to know your employees and find out, how can I help this person to flourish, to do a good job? You need to talk to him or her about what's meaningful for that person. Also, if you don't want a lot of bad days at work, you need to solve the problems that are in the office, in the workplace. And there sometimes are problems. Some of you try to have smaller problems at work. Yeah, a few. And when they're there, sometimes we just, yeah, we need to, okay, focus on the happiness, so let's forget about the problems. Or maybe we just solve them and we don't talk about them. But it's important, if you see there's problems, solve them as fast as possible. And learn, of course, from your mistakes. And also, what could cause a problem is if you have employees or colleagues that are creating a negative culture. Negative behavior is contagious. So if you even have just one employee, maybe the most talented one, in your workplace, that one person is so talented, you think it would be a bad idea to get rid of that person. But if that person is the same person that's creating this negative culture with his or her behavior in the office, you need to get rid of him or her. Or is that just the right thing to do, just to get rid of that person right away? Maybe that person actually just are not happy at work, and you can help that person become happy at work, and suddenly he or she will not be negative anymore. Talk to your people, find out what makes them happy, and if they're not happy, help them to find back being happy at work. What people need, and some need it more than others, and you also heard Helle talk about it, it's praise, it's recognition, it's a positive feedback. Some of us, we need it like every single day. We want to hear it all the time, and that's what motivates us. And for some other people, they don't actually want praise that often. They maybe just want praise once a year when they really think that they deserve it. And that's a really important thing about giving praise and positive feedback. First of all, they should have deserved it, right? It should be authentic. It should be genuine. And most of all, when you give praise, when people deserve praise, give it in a specific way. And also give it in a way that that person will actually approve. It could be asking that person to stand up in a crowd and listen, now we all want to give a big applause for this person because she did an amazing job in this by handling this client or whatever. One person would love that. For another, it will be horrible. They would have a two and two and have a talk and talk about what is it that I really appreciated in what you did with that client. But if you do it two and two or on an all hands meeting, always remember to tell them, this is what you made really good. This is why I see that you're a really good employee. You did it in a right way. It made a difference for me, for the department, for the company, for the client, for the climate, for the world, whatever. Tell why is it that you made a difference? What's the purpose? Where's the meaning in what you did? And you all know Sir Richard Branson? Yeah. He's a leader, a manager that's talking a lot about, he believes that it's the way that you treat your employees is how they will treat your clients. And he certainly believes in giving praise and recognition, and he's doing it a lot. If you follow him on the social media, you see how often he actually takes one person or a team or some of your employees out and tell, look at these people, they're amazing, they did this amazing job. Let's honor them. Let's salute them. And he actually believes by praising, he can make people flourish. And we want our employees to flourish so they do a better job. Also, when we can praise people, it's a way of showing people that they're doing a good job. And that's what we all want to do. We want to do a good job. Often I hear from our clients when we visit clients that, Yeah, the only thing our managers are talking about is about what we didn't do, where we're behind in work, and we didn't reach the KPIs, and we are behind the budget, stuff like that. That's what they hear all the time. The managers often forget to focus on what people actually got done. As a leader, as a manager, as a project leader, anything, if you have people around you, show them that they're making a difference. Tell them what they actually have done. And sometimes it's measurable, and sometimes it's just meaningful progress. And that's really important. Science actually shows that if we know that we're doing meaningful progress, we'll perform better. And it will also affect our feelings and thereby our happiness and our motivation. So let people know when they have done something good, had a good result, or as I just said, just a meaningful progress. When you have a result that's maybe just a bit bigger than just going to work and do your tasks, you should celebrate. And I don't know how many of you guys that have a person like Thomas in the office who can celebrate and have music and segues and I don't know what he brings, mules and everything into the office when they want to celebrate. I heard him say cake. That's always a good idea when you celebrate. Bring cake. People love it. But celebrate your victories, your results. Every time you have something special, and not only once a year. Like, yeah, we'll do that on our all-hands meeting in summer, and we'll do it at the Christmas party. Do it when you have the victory right in front of you. If you had a great result, celebrate immediately. And if you don't have cake, just stand there, put your arms up, and say, woohoo! And you can have the whole company to do that, and they'll feel proud. And we want our employees to feel proud of the job that they do. Then they'll perform better. So celebrate both the small and the big victories. Do you guys that are in the room now that are leaders, do you know your employees really well? Do you know what makes them happy? Do you know exactly what makes them happy? How you, as a leader, can help them flourish? How you can help that person be the best self? Can you teach that person to improve? If they have strengths, can you help them become even better at their strengths, to use their strengths even more? If you know that they are really focused on maybe creating results or teamwork, put them in a situation where they can use that, where they can do that as often as possible, and they'll become happier. This is a task for you as a leader. Know your people. And when you know them, you can help them to do a better job. Every single of your employees are different, and they'll be happier at work from different stuff. And I think it's one of the biggest things that I see go wrong, that leaders are doing so many other things. They're running to meetings, they're talking to clients, they're doing their own things, and they forget about leading. They forget about seeing who are my employees? Who are you? Who are you? And who are you? Because every single person is awesome. And you need to find that awesomeness and help that person with that. And when you know your people, you can do that. We say that happiness at work, when we look into science, that you can actually break it down to only two keystones that you can work on if you want to create a happier workplace. Some of you might know it already because we put it in our books and we put it out in the internet all around. It's results and relationships. We want to help people, we want to focus on and show them that they go to work, they make a difference, that they create meaningful results. They go to work and they make a difference. That's the results, and they need to do it and have time to have great relationships to their colleagues and to their immediate manager. Science shows that if you have a social good relationship with your colleagues, you'll be happier at work and happier in life in general. So that's really amazing. If you have a good relationship with your colleagues, you'll be happier in life. So as a company, even as an employee, you need to kind of ask, we want to have time to spend with our colleagues to create these great relationships. We actually kind of, when we go visit clients, we teach them how to say good morning, to greet each other, to see each other, because we are all human beings, and we need to see each other and to know each other. So also as a leader, that's something you need to do, to put time in the schedule where people can actually talk together and learn to know each other, so they can trust each other, respect each other's work, and have a communication and learn to know each other. But as a leader, how good do you know your employees? Could you take a piece of paper, write all your peers down, the names of all your peers, and could you then on the list say, is this person getting his or her happiness at work from results? Is that what makes it for him? Or is it relationships? And why did I think that it's from the results? What are my observations? Oh, it's because when he create these results, that's what's giving him the kick, as Haley was talking about. And for some other people, it's not creating the results, it's the progress. Or it's doing it together with great people. So we are getting this kick, this happiness at work, out of different stuff. And you should know from each of your employees what's their kick. So this is a simple way to do it. We have this list. And I hope that none of you have a Henry in your peer. He's not one of your peers, because you should know exactly who is your employees. So this is just a simple thing you can go home and do. And if you have a question mark, it's time to go and talk to that person. And when you go and talk to a person, I know this is hard. This is really hard. It's not about talking. It's not about you talking. It's about you listening to your employees. Often we, as leaders, talk too much. We need to listen even more. And that's how we get to know our employees even better. And that's how we can help them to perform better, to be more motivated, engaged, and be more resilient. There's so many changes in all kind of workplaces. So we need resilient employees. And if they're happy, they're more resilient. So know your people and help them to become happy. How can you make other people happy in a way that also actually makes you happy as a person? You all know about random acts of kindness? We actually call it random acts of workplace kindness, where you actually take this into the workplace and you make your colleagues, your peers, or even your boss happy by doing something small. It can be, you know, bring a cup of tea or coffee, water, bring home-baked cake, and it's not your birthday. You know, it's just random. Bring balloons to the office, bring flowers from your garden, whatever, something that you think will make people happy. Put posters on the mirrors at in the toilets that makes people smile. That's also a random act of kindness. And the random acts of workplace kindness is the things you do in the workplace. And I brought one of my favorite videos of two managers from a Danish company called Solar. And these two managers, their names are Carsten and Carsten. Carsten and Carsten actually, some years ago, talked at this conference because they were awesome managers. They did some great things. And they decided, let's do a random act of workplace kindness. Let's surprise our employees. So they remember that saying good morning is really important. It's kind of starting the day in a good way. That's how we want to show our employees that we see them and that we're happy that they actually come to work today. So they decided to do what we call a level 5 good morning. They wanted to stand there and greet everybody in the morning, and they start working at 7 o'clock in this company. So this video is maybe taking around 6:30. So that's quite early. So, but have a look at Carsten greeting their employees one morning. Yeah, and the employees are really surprised. So this is random. This is not happening every single morning, right? This is just one morning there down there. And I know the video was in Danish, but I'm quite sure that you understood the message. That, and people were talking about Carsten and Carsten. You remember that morning they were standing there. They even had breakfast for us. But it wasn't the breakfast, wasn't it? They could have standing there without breakfast. It was them being there, showing their employees that we are here for you. And it made a huge difference. Like weeks after, people talked about it. And that's what you can do. You can make surprise people. For Christmas, they were Santa Claus and Santa Claus walking around delivering stuff for the people where they were working around the office space. They did so many crazy things. You have to, as a leader, do it yourself. You have to walk the talk. If you don't do it, how can you expect your employees to do it? If you don't do it, they don't dare to do it. Because they think, oh, no, because my leader is never smiling. And I think maybe he or she is not happy at all because he's so focused on doing the work all the time. There's no time for smiling. There's no time for creating a happy environment. But if you create this happy environment, we know the company will be more successful. So your role as a leader is, first of all, to create meaning and purpose and to communicate meaning and purpose. And you need to communicate, even for some of you, even I would say more often that you might even do. Communicate, communicate, communicate. One of the things that I often see is that people, some managers communicate a bit too late. So timely communication is really important. You have to involve your employees when you decide stuff, like you just heard from Mette, that they involve their employees. So, how do you want your schedule to look like? Involve them in, we have this organization change. How would you like it to be? Involve them as much as you can so they feel heard. Employees want to be heard. Also, support them. If they have ideas, support them, help them. If they have great ideas, tell them, show them that they can come to you at all times. And if you have to turn them down, tell them why it's not possible. Have a good explanation and they'll understand. But be open-minded and help them and support them if they come up with great ideas. You need at all times, as I said, to be authentic. But it's so important to show trust. Show them that you trust them to do a great job. And, as I said before, walk the talk. It's you out there that can create this wonderful, successful company with the most happy employees in your country. Go out and do it. Thank you.
Thank you, Alette.
You're welcome.
I think we should talk about a little bit about the good morning stuff.
Yeah.
We saw how Carsten and Carsten did it. Hilarious. But you said that you actually teach people how to say good morning.
We do.
So how do you say good morning?
We have what we call a level 5 good morning.
A level 5 good morning.
Yeah. Okay.
What is
I'll
that?
Put the clicker down. Mm-hmm. So all of you guys, let's just look down and pretend that we're very busy working. And say after me, that's a level 1 good morning. It's not that this person is a really bad person, but he or she is really busy. But is that how we want to greet our colleagues? Yes or no? No. Let's take it to a level 2. You're still busy working. And now you're actually saying good morning. So say good morning.
Morning.
Is that okay? No. Okay. Let's take it to a level 3. Now we're actually having eye contact and we are saying good morning, having eye contact, good morning. So do it to your right and left. Say good morning. I know it's not morning anymore. Yeah, what happened? You did something I didn't ask you to do. What did they do, Michael?
They smiled.
They smiled. So, and that's actually creating a relationship right there. So a level 3 good morning is the minimum where we actually want people to be when in the workplace, have eye contact, I see you, you see me, we are people, we are human beings, you're not just a colleague. I see you, good morning, it's great to see you. So it's great to see you, and if I even knew your name, Michael, I can see it on your name tag. Good to see you, Michael. How are you doing? How was your tennis match last night?
It's actually a very beautiful name. I love that name.
You love that name. Yeah.
Michael.
So what I just did, I added your name and I added something extra. That's what we call a level 4 good morning. You're adding something extra. You're showing that you care. You're showing that you know maybe his name. You know if he had a tennis match yesterday, you know that person. And level number 5. Stand up. Let's do it all together. Please stand up. So a level 5 good morning is saying good morning, having eye contact, adding something extra, and maybe a handshake, because you need to touch.
But I'll give you
but
a hug.
We are friends, so we are
hugging. We can do it.
But a handshake, maybe knuckles, if that's more your thing.
Actually, we never tried a handshake, Alette.
Did a handshake.
Yeah.
So,
hey.
Good morning, great to see you. How was Tivoli last night?
Oh, Tivoli was great, only too short.
So, level 5, good morning to 2 people. Go! Thank you so much. Your guys are awesome.
Yeah. Okay. Let's give Alette a level 5 applause. Okay?